Give us grace to cast away the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Now in the time of his mortal life in which your Son, Jesus Christ, came to visit us in great humility, that in the last day, when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge both the living and the dead, we may rise to the life immortal through him who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Thank you.
know what time it is. How it is now the moment for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer to us now than we became believers. The night is far gone, the day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of the darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us live honorably as in the day, not in rebellion and drunkenness, not in debauchery and licentiousness, not in quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for flesh to gratify its desires. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
of all, and Jesus said to his disciples privately about his coming. But about that day and hour, no one knows, neither the angels of heaven nor the Son, only the Father. For as the days of Noah were, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. For as in those days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the days that Noah entered the ark, and they knew nothing until the flood came and swept them all away, so too will be the coming of the Son of Man. Then two will be in the field, one will be taken and one will be left. Two women will be grinding meal together, one will be taken and one will be left. Keep awake, therefore, for you do not know on what day the Lord is coming. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known in what part of the night the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake and would not have let his house be broken into. Therefore, you must also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Saying that absence makes the heart grow fonder. Is this true?
Sometimes
why or why not? I say that to say because Jesus, our Lord and Savior, has been gone for over 2,000 years, and some of us, our hearts are still growing fonder because we are waiting his return. And some have sort of gotten a little lax and gone to sleep and done the other thing, assuming that it would never happen because it didn't happen when someone said it would or when you thought that it might happen. So, Advent. We talked about this last week, the beginning of the Christian year, and the meaning of the season. We have hope, anticipation, joy, and love, which each one of these candles symbolize. We are awaiting the birth of our Savior, the Messiah, the one who is coming to save us and to redeem the world. Now, we talked about this last Sunday, so let's see who was listening. We're in Advent now, so in order to understand Advent, what is the life cycle of Christ? And I'll give you the first answer, Advent. What happens next?
Christmas?
I'm gonna take some confirmation cards back. Christmas. Christmas. What happens after Christmas?
Lent.
We have light here, so what happens after Christmas?
Epiphany. Epiphany.
Then after Epiphany?
Lent.
Lent. After Lent. After Lent. Easter.
Easter.
After Easter. This happens before the day of Pentecost.
Good Sunday.
Ascension. What happens next? Y'all embarrassing for our viewers. The day of Pentecost. The day of Pentecost. And after that, the season after Pentecost, which we concluded last Sunday, and now we're back starting all over. So, we just ended the season of Christ the King, and now we are beginning the season of awaiting the birth of the newborn King. So why is this gospel on the second coming as we await his arrival? It is because, as many commentators and theologians have said, we are in the ages, past, present, and future, that serves as a bridge between the two comings of Christ, one to save the world from sin and the other to take the faithful to the kingdom of heaven. So when will Christ come again? Who knows? Many of us are keenly aware of all the predictions that have been done over the centuries, but no one really knows when Christ will return. Will there be signs? Will there be some kind of cosmic event like an eclipse where the entire world turns dark? Will the moon turn to blood? Will there be a loud trumpet call from Gabriel? You get the idea. Some try to predict, but we are told in Matthew's gospel today that no one knows. So if anyone tries to tell you that they do know, that's a question mark there. And some might say, is he really going to return? It's been over 2,000 years. Why hasn't he come back yet? In Jesus' day, they had a more, I guess, firm belief that it was going to come sooner than later because of their faith. But now, 2,000 years later, a somewhat skeptical society, apathy has set in. Some believe and some do not. We say that we do believe, but we live like we do not believe. Matthew uses the example of Noah to show obedience. Noah is laughed and mocked, as you all know from the story in Genesis, but Noah is doing what God has commanded him to do. There were several who did not pay attention to what Noah was doing, went on about their way until it was too late. Now I was not there, but I'm sure that as the floods came and Noah and his family and all the animals were in the ark, you had folks knocking on the ark, and Noah was probably like, nope, too late, I'm gonna open that door. None of those who laughed and ignored Noah saw the flood coming. There were no mysterious signs of what was to come. Think about us. How many of us have been caught in storms? It's sunshine one day, and 2 minutes later, you're driving in a hailstorm. Well, that happened to me. There was no sign. It was just boom. So what about us today? Many of us are living like those who laughed at Noah, not paying attention to what is going on around us, engulfed in our own lives. And in Matthew's gospel, Jesus has an eye on what is to come and believes something specific is going to happen in the future. But he keeps the attention focused on the present day and the needs of the hour. The example of Noah is used to show us what can happen when we ignore the judgment and power of God. Looking back can remind us of what God can do and will do in God's own time. So what do we do in the meantime? As I mentioned before, we are currently living between two ages, and this is known as the doctrine of the two ages. And if I had a board here, I would draw you two concentric circles, and when those circles meet in the middle is where we are now, because over here is the past, and over here is what is yet to come. We should live each day as if it is our last. This is what the example of the house owner and thief that comes in the night shows us. If we knew for certain the hour, then we would get our acts together for sure. There are plenty of times I can think of being at work, not here, when we knew that somebody was going to come to inspect our work or judge us or whatever, and people are scrambling around trying to get reports together, make sure everything's doing what it's supposed to be doing. And I'm sitting there like, it's all calm or whatever, because when you do what you're supposed to do, then when the man comes, you don't have to go around trying to find lost reports and you can sign stuff and your heart's not racing 25 miles an hour. And I always like to give the example of the church that I came from. The bishop would just drop in unexpectedly and just show up. And you see people scrambling, the bishop's here. And I'm sitting there all calm and collected because I'm ready to go. So your house should always be in order. It's not when you think the bishop is coming or somebody else is coming, visitors, your house should always be in order. So that when someone comes, whether it be a visitor or the bishop or whoever, you're not panicking, you're saying, yes, come on in. One of the things I did at my last church, I always made sure the church was in order every day because people would drop by and say, oh, we were just in town and I got married here, can I come see the church? I'm like, sure. I was trying to explain why there was something wrong with the ceiling or the floor or whatever. I said, come on in, because everything is ready to roll. And we should live our lives in the same way. And how many of you right now, if someone said, I want to come visit you today, would your house be in order? And by order, I mean, you're not trying to hide clothes behind the closet or trying to get stuff out of the way. And I'm gonna practice what I preach. I have a friend who wants to come over today to see my apartment because he's thinking about moving into my building. I gotta go home and get all this stuff just out of the way. Just gotta be pushed out of the way so he doesn't see it. The message for us is that we should live in faith, that we will be ready for anything at any time, good times and bad times, the unexpected things that life brings our way. How we handle these things shows our readiness for the unexpected. And do not assume that you will be ready for something if you have not prepared yourself in the event that it did happen. What if you suddenly, without warning, lost your job? Was suddenly given a grave diagnosis? A flood destroyed your home? You became bankrupt? How would you handle it? Would you be ready? Would your faith be strong enough and hope in the return of the risen Lord stay true? Our message of hope is given in the gospel lesson for today. Hope that we can begin to live our lives as if Christ will return any day now. It is never too late to live as we ought to live, as Christ would have us to live. We should live each day, as I said, as if it were our last. In our daily goings and comings, and especially in our walk with Christ, we should be like Noah, always doing what is asked of us, what is required of us, even if those around us do not understand or even mock us. In the early days of the church, it may have been easier to live in a state of watchfulness, but now, 2,000 plus years later, it seems that this is a much harder to do for some. There are only so many times we can be warned to be on our best behavior, our best Christ-like behavior, just in case. Now, for the faithful, we believe that Jesus will come again, and it will be a great day. The faithful believe and live by this. Do not be like Noah, and do not be like those in the days of Noah, ignoring the signs, continuing to live as usual, not having a clue as to what is about to come. It's not if he returns, but when. The date of the return of Christ is a closely guarded secret. No one knows it, and no one can know it. Only Christ knows that day. Our lives should reflect the faith that we proclaim to have in Christ, the one true living bread, the one whose birth we anticipate in this season of Advent, his first coming and then Christ's return. His second coming we await today. And as usual, I'm going to leave you with a question to ponder over this week. How many of us have anxiety about the future, whether it be the coming of Christ or your own faith journey or what is to become of me if I were to perish tomorrow? Will I go to heaven or will I be floating around somewhere, as some of you think, in purgatory, or where will I land? If that anxiety is there, it means we might need to sort of tighten up a little bit on our faith journey. And if you need help with that, I'd be glad to talk with you about that. But what images do you have of Christ when he returns in glory? And what would happen if he arrived in a way unexpected? We all have this vision of, like I said, some big, gigantic event, and Christ is going to appear, but none of us has ever seen Christ. And how do we know that Christ has not already been here? Just to see what's going on. We don't. We have these visions based upon artistic drawings of what Christ looked like. Maybe Christ could have been the visitor that came into the doors last week and no one talked to him. Maybe Christ could have been the homeless man who was sitting outside the street. Maybe Christ could have been that person who needed your help and you didn't have time to offer your help, whether it be answering the phone call at 2 in the morning or just stopping just to hear what was going on. We do not know what Christ looks like, and we do not know in which way Christ will come again. So, as I asked previously, what images do you have of Christ's return in glory? Are they big and grand with trumpets and cymbals? And again, what would happen if Christ arrived in a way unexpected? What would happen if Christ arrived today? As we prepare for Christmas, the church reminds us of the coming of Jesus at the end of the world. While this might seem contrary to the season, let us remember that whether Christ comes in glory or as a poor child, the results are the same. The second coming and Christmas invite us to come closer to the Lord, Both urge us to approach the Lord without delay, even through events of the world, even though events of the world distract us. And if we are watching the news lately, there were a lot of unexpected events that happened that I'm sure people did not even anticipate. There was a shooting, I believe, in Florida, in Colorado. I'm sure no one was expecting that. You have planes going down all the time. You have auto accidents. You have just unexpected things that happen in life each day. So always be ready, but you do not know when your last day is. Well, as I said, do we know when Christ is going to come again? So as we have some of those anxieties, reflect on your anxieties this week and bring them to the Lord in prayer and pray for the peace to survive the unexpected. Amen.
Amen.
All standing, please turn to page 356 in the book of Common Prayer.
Father, we pray for your whole Catholic Church. Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
For yours is the majesty, O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory. now and forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins to God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess our sins against you and thought for our deeds by the love we have done and by the love we have left undone. We cannot love you with our whole heart. We cannot love our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and come to repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may be like in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm making a few notes on the floor. I want to first thank all our visitors who are here today. Please feel free to come back and worship with us at any time. We'd be very glad to have you. If you would, after service, sign one of the visitors' cards if they're not in your pew and put them in the offertory plate so that I can stay in touch with you. Great. We ask for traveling mercies for Rudy and Corliss as they travel back from New York. We ask for healing mercies, actually, for Elliot Brown and Grayson. They both had little accidents this week. But Elliot is a trooper. He texted me and said, I'm moving a little slow, but I'm coming. Okay. Birthdays. Maxima Holmes, Dorothy Shiver, and Beverly Ray, if you are here, please come forward. And Ms. Shiver's family is not here today because they are celebrating her birthday with her elsewhere. Let us pray. Most gracious God, we give you thanks for your servant Beverly, who stands here before you. We give you thanks for her dedication and work here at the church. I ask that you keep her in good spirits, good mind, good volunteer spirit that she has. And above all else, I ask that you grant her many, many more birthdays upon this earth. And all these things I ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
She walked away, so she doesn't want to share her age.
I'll be ready for the seniors.
Okay. She said she'll be ready for the seniors lunch, and that's my hint. Okay. We do have fellowship after the service in the parish hall, so please make your way back there. I just want to draw your attention to the first announcement that's in your bulletin regarding the giving tree. I have yet to receive the big giant box that they normally give us to put out front, but if you're out and about this week and you run across a toy or something that you want to pick up, you can bring it to the church and put it in the giving box out front. And those will be collected, I believe, on December 11th. This coming Saturday, we will have something in this church that we have not had since 2009. We have a wedding. If you look in your bulletin, next to the last page, Ms. Stephanie Thompson and Mr. Brian Baldwin will be celebrating their impending marriage on this coming Saturday at 1:30 in the afternoon. And I'm looking very forward to that. I did tell the third that he wanted lots of smoke.
So thank he said, you.
Just a little trivia, just for fun. When was the last marriage sale here? How many years ago?
2009.
That's correct. Who was it?
Levi.
Not quite. I'm going to say it, Levi. Hold on. John, Gioni Palmer, and Ashley Brooks Scott. And after that was 2008, we had Levi Barry Johnson III and Venetia Pinoy Martin. Patrick Walcott Coakley married Rebecca Ann Hare. So this is our first wedding here in our math challenge, 13 years? Yeah. So it's a big deal. And I believe that's all I have to announce for today. We need more marriages and we need more babies.
Okay, no babies.
Hey, Virgin Mary, it happened. You got miracles. Never say never.
No.
Everyone calm down. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name, bring offerings and come into his courts.
Thank you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because you sent your beloved Son to redeem us from sin and death, and to make us heirs in of everlasting life. And when he shall come again in power and great triumph to judge the world, we may without shame or fear rejoice to behold his appearing. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Thank you.
receive the sacrament of the body of Christ and the blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in the sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to the heavenly country where with Luke, the Virgin Mary, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation.
For him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Amen.
Glory we await, made you steadfast in faith, joyful in hope, and constant in love.
Amen.
May you rejoice in the first advent of our Redeemer, and his second advent be rewarded with unending love.
Amen.
And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain.